There were some absolutely outstanding entries, and I'm very pleased that we've been able to award some really solid winners here, showing both innovation and actual practical results in lower carbon, more efficient use of resources, less waste, a more environmentally sustainable approach to the whole way in which they do business. There were, of course, a range of different entries. There were some which were absolutely brilliant. There were others that were doing good work, but not really innovating in the sort of way that, some of the winners were. But overall, very impressive lot of entries. The renewable energy category was really interesting because it was a mixture of companies and organizations that were finding new ways of producing renewable energy and companies that were finding much better ways of using renewable energy. And of course, for people in the wider world, how to use renewable energy well and effectively and more is of course one of the, major things that we need to be doing more of. The waste category was an interesting category. There was some very good practice going on. I think overall we were a tiny bit disappointed that there wasn't more innovation going on in this category. Some really good things happening from the winners, and there were one or two others that were in pretty close contention. But I think it could have been a stronger category overall. I would say to people, look at not just doing the stuff that you ought to be doing, but think about what more you can do, how you can go the extra mile, how you can innovate, how you can look at the whole spread of what your business is about and make that better. There's also a message, I think, that if some of the really major companies that we've made awards to this year can do it, then actually anyone can. And the key message to business is being more environmentally sustainable. It's not only good for the environment, not only good for reducing your carbon footprint, but it's also good for your bottom line as a business. It makes you more efficient, and that's a really good message to get across.
I thought the standard of the entries this year was really good. What I particularly liked to see was the amount of innovation And the number of entries where people are really looking at how these could have broader applicability. I think for me it's always about striking that balance between technological innovation but also about what's going to bring about behaviour change, and I think that's what's really exciting going forward is how we bring about that wider change in behaviour. Well, actually, there's quite a lot of similarity in these, but I think it is really taking forward the technological side, but again, combining it with the need to think about the bigger behaviour change that we all need to make in the way we live our life.
I thought it was a tremendously high quality of entries, right through for some really big international schemes, such as the London Bike Hire Scheme, right through to some really good local initiatives and things being done by small companies that have really transformed their operations using electric bikes and electric vehicles and things like that. Enormous diversity, but showing that the sector is becoming much more vibrant as a whole. I think there's going to be a lot more electric vehicles in the future, but I think we have to be realistic about how quickly they're going to enter into the market. But there's a lot of new other technologies which are out there. There's new fuels such as biomethane coming forward in trucks and HGVs. There's obviously electric vehicles, fuel cell vehicles which are going to start to be coming onto the market from 2015. And there's an awful lot that people can simply do in terms of better fleet management to reduce the amount of vehicle use that's going on. So a lot happening and a lot coming through in these awards. I think the big thing to do is make sure that you're really trying to quantify the benefits which are coming out of your scheme, whether it be reduced journeys or CO2 emissions. And I think the other thing is really make a compelling case for how you're working, either with your stakeholders or your employees, to make it happen on the ground. Well, from low CVP in the next few months, I think in particular we've been doing a lot of work looking at what the cost of future technologies are going to be, and I would expect us to take that through to actually see how we can be incentivising new technology much more effectively in the future. And I hope we'll have a big new announcement on commercial vehicles very soon to really start get the market moving for lower carbon technologies in that sector.
Well, I'm relatively new to this sector, although I have been the Mayor's Transport Advisor for 3 years. But I was actually really taken back by the amounts of work, and yes, the broad range of it, and the depth. So the quality's been really high, and it's been quite a struggle, actually, to actually find some faults and failings where you could actually take marks off. So I may be generous in the way I've awarded marks. You know, when times are difficult, when money is tight, it actually makes people raise their game. They know they've got to compete more to attract that investment, to attract that attention. And I think it means that people put in that much more effort. Not that they weren't putting effort in before, but I think because the competition is such, it has raised people's game. Well, I think that's the big challenge for me and the mayor. There's been a lot of great work that the GLA do, working with other partners, organisations, and actually it's about making clear what is it that we're trying to achieve. I know the mayor set a target to reduce CO2 by 60% by 2025. I'm saying, how do we solve a problem like 60, and putting that challenge to everyone? But then we've got other issues around air quality and what we're doing in terms of tree planting, our water quality and energy efficiency. But all of it is part of that one key question: how do we become more sustainable? And I'm reveling in that. I'm really enjoying the challenge. And I think the next 12 months and beyond are very exciting because there's not a time limit on this agenda. Keep up the hard work. I think the challenge is just going to continue to grow. People's actual appetite for what they think they can achieve is growing because they see people succeeding with ambitious schemes, ambitious ideas. And I think it's be ambitious. Really go for it.
I think it's really interesting when you look at the kind of the diversity of applications, and I think it's the quality was reasonable. I think I'm always looking for things which are genuinely transformative, people who have really focused on, you know, quite radical innovation, which delivers big changes and big impacts on the ground. So I think there was some evidence of that this year. So the overall quality is good, but yeah, I think it could still be a lot better. I think we're all still falling short of my own personal expectations and what needs to be done, but I say that about everything. There's two sort of big areas. One is on the sort of negotiation side of things. I think some of the entries this year looked actually how you negotiate with suppliers, and actually there's huge scope for innovation actually on a contractual and sourcing type basis, which I think can help to transform the market as the evidence of feed-in tariffs and those type of government initiatives have proven. In terms of actually specific technologies, I'd be a little bit hesitant to say, oh, it should be anaerobic digestion, it should be air source pumps, it should be solar PV, because actually I think all of them have got a role to play and all of them are going to be important. What I want to see, what I would like to see is applications and ideas which can genuinely be taken to scale and actually potentially have a huge benefit for UK industry and technology. Because, you know, we all know in economically chastened times, we want to see the strong technology ideas coming through which will benefit for green jobs in the UK. The feed-in tariffs did. I think the review has maybe taken it a step back again. I just think we're suffering from a little bit of short-term short-sightedness. You know, we know that all of this stuff has to be done. It's probably inevitable, indeed arguably essential. So any kind of procrastination or thing which, any aspect which delays the ongoing implementation is going to be problematic. So sometimes I think we're cutting our nose off to spite our face, but trying to make short-term savings, but we know there's really enormous long-term gains to be had. Well, it's quite interesting. From Futera, in the next 12 months, we're just celebrating our 10th anniversary, so we're very much doing a kind of retrospective, you know, review of where the whole market has come in the last 10 years, and now we're looking to what happens in the next decade. And you will probably see us doing a lot more radical things in terms of the narrative and the vision that we're trying to talk about, because I think what's holding back a lot of changes, whether it's in energy, whether it's in food or transport, is the really compelling, exciting, positive vision of where we're trying to get to. And I think without that, we remain mired in the status quo and short-term considerations. So expect to see some more transformative visions of where UK and the world might go in the context of sustainability.
Yeah, so the quality of the wards in Edie just grow and grow, improve every year. So, yeah, great delight to see the whole industry moving on, as demonstrated by some of these great applications. I think what people are starting to realise actually is that by being green, you can actually be more efficient, you can use your resources more effectively, you can reduce waste, you can build things more effectively. And if you get it right, actually, you can save costs and at the same time be greener. So I think there's a starting to be a realisation that being green and being a better business go hand in hand, so that's positive. I think we're at the early stages of really everybody out there understanding that within their own homes they need to do something about reducing their energy bills. Of course, as energy prices and bills rise, people will give it more attention. You know, and I think we've got a long way to go actually before people really start investing in their homes in a way that helps to reduce the CO2 arisings. So the government initiatives that are being developed, but as yet are not implemented, are very, very important to get right, as are a number of other initiatives that are helping to move things forward. China is developing very, very fast, and it's now moved into a position where it really needs help. It needs new products, it needs expertise to help them to meet their demand. They can't meet the demand from within their country. And following a meeting with the Prime Minister in December and a visit by Vice Premier Li Keqiang with Vince Cable to our innovation park at BRE in January, we've now signed this accord with Bunker, who are China's largest developer. In fact, I believe they're the world's largest developer, to really take our products and show what we can do in Britain with a view to growing exports within China. And the way we're going to do that is we're going to build an innovation park in southwest Beijing, where we really showcase the best of British. A number of things we're planning for the next 12 months. Clearly we've got our international growth that's really important for us, and we're just opening up in Canada as well. We've got an operation now in North America, in the USA, and in China and other places. And what we're doing there is we're taking our standards and our research knowledge to help those countries meet the opportunities and challenges they have in a consistent way that we we've been doing within the UK for a while. And what we very much want to do is we want to take with us all those organisations and people out there and the companies that are able to help these countries to deliver better outcomes. So that's an international outlook. But here in the UK, we continue our pioneering research work, moving and extending sustainability to include more socio-sustainability measures and economic sustainability measures. So first of all, if you are entering the awards next year and you wanted a bit of advice on what to do, you know, what are your outcomes? Clearly describe your outcomes. Realise that those around you are getting rather good at this, you know, and have real ambition to deliver outcomes that matter. And think more about socio and economic sustainability alongside environmental sustainability. I think one of the real areas that's going to grow over the next year or so, or realisation is going to grow, is that materials and products have an enormous amount to contribution to make when it comes to delivering more sustainable buildings. Thinking about what products to select, looking at how they fit together, looking at how you can design things so you keep buildings cool or warm without lots of need for conditioning and other systems is really going to, you're going to see that coming up. And the other thing, reason you're going to see that is because as we go for greener buildings with lower operational carbon, the embodied carbon and other environmental impacts of the materials that are used to construct them or refurbish them, the balance is less in the operational side and is becoming more on the embodied side. So you're going to see more emphasis, I think, on materials.